policy responses. And we're delighted to have with us Benoit Gomis, who has been the proud author of this work, which came out earlier in the year. And I think it's an excellent assessment of an important public policy challenges that our governments and indeed our societies face. And I suppose in full disclosure, I should say that I wrote the foreword to it, so I have a little bit of a vested interest, but I'm sure you will see and appreciate the merits. Benoit Gomis has a number of affiliations. I won't go over all of them at the moment, but he has for many years worked at Chatham House. He's an affiliate of Chatham House, which is the home of the famous rule in London, England. It's also the more common name of the Royal Institute for International Affairs. He is also an associate faculty member of Royal Roads University, a little closer to home, and a research associate with Simon Fraser University. As I said, his work came out earlier this year, and I think to a general acclaim, and Benoit will lead us through the main elements of his talk and indeed the book, and then he's very open to some questions and answers afterwards. So without further ado, Benoit.
Thank you very much. Thanks very much, Paul, for this very kind, although slightly, you know, subjective and biased introduction. So you'll have to bear with me while I try and hop back and forth between the keyboard and the space. But yeah, let's get started. Thank you, first of all of you for coming. So this is what we'll talk about today, this book. And let's start with this. I'm sure most important question for you all, where can you find this book? You always need to start with a bit of shameless promotion. So the answer is online. So on the CRC Press website, we used a discount code that the publisher kindly provided to us today. So it's AWB22, you get a 25% discount, just you. You can also find it on Amazon, Routledge, Waterstones. And you can preview parts of the book if you're not convinced yet at the end of the talk. So that includes the very kind foreword that Paul Meyer wrote in this book. On the CRC Press website, you also find some reviews from Michael Gerben, for example, who's a former FBI agent who's now a fellow at NYU, New York University, former FBI whistleblower, as well as a review from George Casimiris, who's a professor of strategic studies at the University of Wolverhampton in the UK, and he wrote one of my favorite books on terrorism, apart from this one, of course, called Playing Politics with Terrorism, which I recommend as well. And another very kind review by Kato Hemingway, who's a senior advisor to the Norwegian government. But here is an outline of what I'd like to talk about today. I really wanted to focus on the three or four main arguments of the book. First of all, the idea that since 9/11, Western governments have often oversimplified the threat posed by terrorism, but also overplayed and overreacted to it, which has led to a series of unintended, yet foreseeable and negative consequences that really outweigh their benefits. And that's what I call the six dangers of overreaction. And on this topic, I actually wrote a piece that came out yesterday for Open Canada, which I recommend as well, of course. And then I'll end with 10 sort of broad policy guidelines on the topic of how to tackle the terrorist threat. But first of all, let's talk about oversimplification and this very crucial and fundamental question: what is terrorism? I think it's very important to really start with a definition here. There has been lots of debates about this, lots of disagreements. For example, Kofi Annan and terrorism professor Alex Schmidt a couple of decades ago tried and come up with a consensus on a definition within the UN, but those efforts really failed. And you know, I think the difficulty of coming up with a single definition really shows or brings us back to the saying, one man's terrorist is not the man's freedom fighter. And here's a quote that I really like to give you a sense of how frustrating those discussions and debates about definitions must have been at the UN. This is Sir Jeremy Greenstock, who was a British ambassador to the UN at the time, and he gave this very short remark on the topic. Basically, let us be wise and focused about this. Terrorism is terrorism. What looks, smells, and kills like terrorism is terrorism. So I can understand where Sir Jeremy is coming from, but I do have a slightly more nuanced definition to share with you. And to me, these are the five most important elements of any strong definition of terrorism. The first one is the use of violence or threat thereof. The second one is targeting civilians by non-state actors with the intent to cause fear and panic and with the ultimate goal of bringing about political change. So really, it's the issue of violence. So for example, we hear very often about cyber terrorism, but it's, to me, very often a misnomer, because if there's no violence associated to it, or no threat of violence associated to it, should we consider hacktivism, as we call it, or cybersecurity? Or this kind of things. Really targeting civilians by non-state actors. So state attacks really fall within a remit of, you know, international law and the laws of war and these kind of things, and not terrorism. So again, this intention to cause fear and panic, and that political goal and objective, ultimately. But for more on definitions, Wiz Richardson, Mia Bloom, and others have done some great work on this. And yet, you know, despite this very broad and multifaceted term, what we often associate with terrorism is this. So Islamist terrorism, resorting to nuclear weapons, something very spectacular, very effective, that comes from abroad, but it still strikes very close to home. But if we look at some of the key facts and figures of terrorism in the past 10 or 15 years, I think we see a much more nuanced picture. So I'm gonna show you some key figures that I really like on terrorism that really give a good picture. And these are from the Global Terrorism Database, which is run by the START Consortium at the University of Maryland. But I'd like to start with two or three caveats on the Global Terrorism Database, which is probably the best one out there, but there's still a couple of reminders about what it entails and what it doesn't, and some of these, the problems associated with it. First of all, there are many entries within the database that could very conceivably not be considered terrorism. So for example, there's lots of demonstrations in the south of France, especially where I'm from, during which, you know, paint, rocks, stones, for example, were thrown at the residence of a local MP, and that was considered terrorism. Or there were some shootings, killings that had neither a political objective nor a political target, and that yet were considered terrorism as well. So again, in my hometown of Saint-Provence, 30 or 40,000 inhabitants, there was an explosion against a car on a parking lot that was next to a prison. It was of a prison warden, and we never found who did it, we never found what the goals were, and yet that was part of, that is now part of the Global Terrorism Database, even though, you know, it might have been an organized crime-related explosion or something more personal, we don't know what yet it is in the database. Second caveat is that, you know, when multiple buildings, for example, are targeted at the same time, they count as separate attacks. So for example, in May 2012 in Corsica, so there was an evening when 24 vacation homes were attacked in the same building in the same evening, and those counted as 24 separate attacks, even though many would argue that it should really count as one, because they were the same perpetrator with a coordinated campaign. So I think this is sort of debatable methodology as well. And the third one is that there is some unreported information, especially on far-right terrorism. So if you take the example of Maxime Brunori, who was a far-right militant with a clear political objective to killed President Jacques Chirac on the 14th of July, 2002. So he didn't show any sign of mental illness. He had very clear motives. He felt that there was too many people, too many immigrants in the country, and wanted really to fight back and express a political message. And that was in part of the global terrorism database. So again, lots of criticism, not really to unfairly criticize the global terrorism database, because it is incredibly difficult. Job to do, but more more as a reminder that we should take it with a grain of salt. That being said, I think it does give a good overall picture of the best we can get, really, of terrorism worldwide. And here are some main characteristics. First of all, terrorism is a very highly localized problem that is really centered on conflict-ridden countries. So 78% of terrorist fatalities in 2004 actually occurred in only five countries: Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nigeria, and Syria. And since 1971, 5% of world countries accounted for 50% of the world's terrorist attacks, and 10% of the world's countries accounted for 75% of the world's terrorist attacks. So really something that happens primarily in a small number of countries. Terrorism is also concentrated in time and follows what we call in criminology the burstiness pattern, whereby when a terrorist attack occurs, another terrorist attack is likely to occur very shortly after, either as a result of what we call the copycat effect, or because it is part of a sort of series of coordinated attacks. Terrorism is also often domestic, so we often hear about international terrorism, transnational threats, and these kind of things, but actually over 90% of all terrorist attacks since 1971 have been domestic, so carried out by one national against a national target and with no help from anyone from outside the country. Number four, these attacks, so terrorist attacks since 1971, are often not lethal, so 56% of them since 1971 have not caused any fatalities. They also very often resort to low-tech weapons, so that is 80% of them use firearms and explosives like grenades, like IEDs, simple technologies. And finally, Islamic terrorism is really only one type of terrorism among many others, and in recent media coverage, especially since 9/11, really focus on Islamist terrorism, but actually separatist and left-wing terrorism really accounts for the bulk of terrorist attacks since 1970. For example, if you look at this list of the 10 most active terrorist organizations in attack frequency and number of fatalities, you can see that a lot of them are actually separatists or from sort of a left-wing ideology. We of course see some Islamist terrorist organization in there as well, like al-Qaeda or al-Qaeda in Iraq, or Hamas, but pretty overwhelmingly it is primarily sort of separatist and left-wing movements. Now let's talk about the second big ideas of overreaction, and this quote that still surprises me. Between 2002 and 2007, one book in English was published on the topic of terrorism every 6 hours. You might ask, why are you writing another one to add to that problem? But I hope it does provide a slightly different angle. And if you look at this graph, which shows the proportion of books published with the word terrorism in the title between 1980 and 2008, you see the spike after 9/11, really this great focus that we've had on terrorism, and that's really come at the expense of other topics as I'll talk about later on. But important thing to recognize is that terrorism around 9/11 was actually at one of its lowest points in modern history. So there were five times as many attacks in 1992 as in 2001, And since then, terrorist attacks have been on the rise, with the 1992 level that are similar to the 2008 and 2010 levels, and the number of terrorist attacks have increased even more since then. But a big chunk of it is really related, closely related to the 2003 invasion of Iraq. So if you look at this graph, you see the spike in the number of terrorist attacks after March 2003. So in 2002, there was only 6 attacks, terrorist attacks in Iraq. In the first 12 months after the invasion, 78, then 302 in the second 12 months, and then more than 3,000 a year in 2014. So really from 6 attacks in 2002 to over 3,000 per year today. And it is important to talk as well about the recent increase in terrorist activity worldwide, which is largely explained by the conflicts in Iraq and Syria. So an increase of 61% in terrorism fatalities between 2012 and 2013, and an increase of 81% the year after that. Over 9,400 people have been were kidnapped in terrorist attacks last year, which is 3 times as many as in 2013. And overall, terrorism caused over 32,000 deaths and more than 34,000 injuries in 2014. But I think it's also important to look at this question, you know, is terrorism actually on the rise in the Western world as well? Because we see a clear increase in counterterrorism powers and budgets, and doesn't really match a sort of increase in the actual level of the threat domestically. And if you look at this graph, which is the evolution of terrorist attacks in the UK, Canada, the US, France, and Germany between 1990 and 2014, well, the answer is not really. You know, the terrorism seems to be on the decline as well, actually since 1990, with, you know, a bit of a recent rise recently. But if you look at 2013 and 2012, for example, as I said, you know, there were lots of coordinated attacks in Corsica, so 50 in 2 different nights, that really account for half of those attacks. So again, the terrorist threat actually to what the Western world actually seems to be declining, which goes against the sort of media coverage and political discourse that we often come across these days. And you know, the other question could be, well, what about the lethality? What about the fatalities related to terrorist attacks? Is that actually on the rise? And the answer, again, is not really. So the spike of 2005 was, of course, the attacks against public transport in London, 7/7, with 57 fatalities. But since then, the number of fatalities has not really increased. So, and I think, you know, it's, you know, we very often hear a lot of inflammatory statements about terrorism, a lot of threat inflation going on. So I think it's important to put all those things into perspective. And if you look at the number of fatalities between 2002 and 2014, for example, you'll see that 11 people were killed in terrorist attacks in France, 8 in Germany, 74 in the UK, 61 in the US, and 4 in Canada. And, you know, those are 186 people in total that died in terrorist attacks in those countries. And those are 186 too many, but these estimates, although they might underestimate the scope of terrorist activities in these 5 countries, they do not come anywhere near the figures that commentators and politicians had predicted in the aftermath of 9/11. And importantly, if you compare it with organized crime, for example, you'll see that 13 times more people were actually killed in homicides than in terrorist attacks last year. So almost 500,000 compared to over 32,000. And 26,000 people died in homicides in Mexico alone in 2013. In just one country. Or 56 people died in homicides in Brazil last year as well. 644 people were murdered on the streets of El Salvador in June in a country the size of Toronto, and yet it barely gets any media coverage or any response by any politicians in the Western world. This is, you know, slightly different, of course, and it requires a very different response, but smoking kills 6 million people every year worldwide. So again, I think it is very important to put terrorism into perspective. Now, I don't want to make it sound like we should base all our policy decisions only on fatality figures, because cybersecurity, for example, has not caused any deaths so far. But these fatality figures are to me important because they give some sense of perspective in a field which often lacks perspective. But of course, terrorism is about much more than just fatality and casualty figures. So this is a picture in the only a few hours after the attacks against Charlie Hebdo in Paris, and you know only 17 people died in terrorist attacks there in early January this year. Yet over 3 million people marched all over France to honor the victims, defend the freedom of expression, and demonstrate their strength and resilience, which was to me an admirable reaction. And this is, of course, not the sort of reaction we would expect, you know, after a car crash or after the equivalent of people dying of lung cancer, for example. Terrorism is about much more than just killing people. As Brian Jenkins once noted, terrorists want a lot of people watching. It's about creating fear and political overreaction. And what I'd like to stress today is that by overreacting to terrorism, by overplaying the terrorist threat, we play into the hands of terrorists who indeed want to cause that fear and panic and want to bring that political change that we talked about earlier on with regard to definition. So in other words, the figures and a qualitative analysis of trends worldwide show that terrorism is an important problem that we can and should manage and mitigate, but it is not an existential threat. So what does policy overreaction look like? You know, of course, part of it is subjective. Political decisions are made and are set not just on objective evidence and numbers, but really about, you know, those are based on more subjective visions of what we want for our countries and societies, on our perceptions of what is right or wrong. But to me, this overreaction since 9/11 has manifested itself in four main ways. First of all, spending too much money, disregarding the rule of law, putting in place extensive intelligence programs, and overplaying the terrorist threat in the discourse. So if we talk about spending too much money, John Mueller and Mark Stewart assessed in 2011 that the US had spent an additional $1 trillion on counterterrorism security measures, excluding the costs of foreign wars in Iraq and in Afghanistan. And Bruce Schneier notes here that the regulatory safety goal in the US is of between $1 and $10 million per life saved, and argues that in order for the $100 billion we have spent per year on counterterrorism to be worth it, it would need to have saved 10,000 lives per year. And I think it would be difficult for policymakers and even intelligence analysts to argue that it has, given, for instance, the sort of terrorism trends that we just explored in the first section. So in terms of disregarding the rule of law, what I mean is creating new sort of extrajudicial processes, new legislative frameworks with little accountability, little scrutiny, and measures that would otherwise be considered illegal or unconstitutional in other fields. But since 9/11, terrorism has often been considered a threat so severe that it does justify overreach. So, for example, you know, there's quite a few of those, but the use of torture, drone strikes, Guantanamo Bay, and so on and so forth. But again, overreacting has also manifested itself through these extensive surveillance and intelligence programs with very little review and oversight. So many were revealed by Edward Snowden recently, but as early as 2010, the Washington Post published a study called Top Secret America, which found that more covert operations were launched in the aftermath of 9/11 than during the entire 45 years of the Cold War. And the last important point about what overreacting to terrorism really means, it is to mean overplaying the terrorist threat in the political discourse. So in the lead up to the French military intervention in Mali, for example, François Hollande and his government insisted on the direct threat that al-Qaeda and Islamic Maghreb posed to France. And French interests have indeed been targeted in the region, but AQIM, al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, poses only a very limited direct threat to the French territory as such, and the group really lacks a capacity to strike in Europe or across the Atlantic. And to me, the actual objectives of the French military intervention in Mali were legitimate. You know, it was really to prevent the killings of innocents and to stabilize the country in the broader region. But over relying on a counterterrorism narrative as a justification for military intervention is problematic in the sense that it distracts from the more important issues of weak governance, corruption, human rights abuses by governments, lack of socioeconomic development and overall instability, and towards the overhyped, oversimplified, and all-encompassing threat of terrorism. So why is that a problem, you might ask? Isn't it better to be safe than sorry? Well, to me, there are six dangers of overreacting to terrorism that really outweigh their benefits. First of all, the issue of opportunity costs. So all the time, energy and money that we spent on terrorism has not been spent on other crucial issues, threats, risks, and broader socioeconomic developments, like organized crime, cybersecurity, Russia, China, climate change, or the Arab Spring. You know, opportunities were missed because we focused too much on terrorism. And our national security and foreign policy priorities were to some extent skewed towards terrorism in the aftermath of 9/11. So if you look at this graph again, showing the number of books published on terrorism and organized crime between 95 and 2005, you see this spike in publication on the topic of terrorism that is not really matched in any way by an increase in the number of publication on organized crime, even though organized crime remains a very important challenge to be analyzed and tackled. And if you compare the proportion of books published with the word terrorism, global warming, China, organized crime, cyber, or Russia between 1980 and 2008, you can see as well that if for anything not related to terrorism remains stable, but really again the spike around after 9/11 about publications on terrorism. And when it comes to opportunity costs, if you look at Canada, for example, a lot of the law enforcement resources that were devoted to tackling organized crime and different kinds of illicit trade after 9/11 were actually shifted to national security and terrorism. And again, the same process has reoccurred in the past couple of years following the attacks in Central Richelieu and Ottawa last year. Now, overreaction also creates fear and again, a sense of priorities with some sense of, with some disconnect with reality. So for example, according to the Chatham House YouGov survey, which is published annually, you are more likely to consider terrorism as the biggest threat to the UK if you live outside the historically more affected regions of London or Northern Ireland. Or the study by the STAR Consortium at the University of Maryland found that Americans are more likely to think about the possibility of a terrorist attack than hospitalization or violent crime victimization, although statistics, of course, point to a much smaller likelihood. And as Finu Brzezinski, this is probably not how you pronounce it, but who is a former well-known American official and former national security advisor to President Jimmy Carter, for example, has he wrote an article on how the war on terror created a culture of fear. Fear obscures reason, intensifies emotions, and makes it easier for demagogic politicians to mobilize the public on behalf of the policies they want to pursue. And reactions are indeed much more emotional than rational when it comes to terrorism, and governments should aim to address this fear and misperceptions. Number three, overreaction to terrorism leads to discrimination, especially against Muslims. So shortly after 9/11, this so-called voluntary interview program was launched in the US in order to compile a list of foreigners whose characteristics were similar to those of 9/11 hijackers. So characteristics included type of visa, the country that issued passport, their age, date of entry into the US. So in other words, a branch of the US government specifically targeted a group of innocent individuals. 7,000 people were on that list, that all turned out to be innocent, based on the mere similarity of their profile to those of the perpetrators of 9/11. And that didn't happen just in the US, but also in other countries like Germany, for example. In the UK, stops and searches of individuals of what they call their Asian origin, which is Pakistan, Afghanistan, you know, South Asia, really, carried out under counterterrorism powers increased threefold after 9/11 and fivefold after the attempted attacks in London and Glasgow in 2007. And under Section 44, after appropriate authorization, a person could be legally stopped and searched by police officers to look for articles that could be used to carry out terrorist attacks, regardless of whether there was any reasonable suspicion that these objects were being carried or that these acts of terrorism would occur in the area covered by the authorization. But between 2001 and 2010, Section 4 was used for over 500,000 stops that have led to only 283 terrorism-related arrests and zero conviction for terrorism-related offenses. Overreaction also leads and has led to inadequate and often ineffective and harmful policies. So the challenges that Afghanistan, Pakistan, Syria, Iraq, Nigeria, and other countries face are obviously much more diverse, complex than just terrorism. You know, they're about government, governance, corruption, development, the economy, inequalities, institutions, and so on and so forth. So those are very important things to tackle and to address. But an approach primarily or too heavily centered on terrorism and counterterrorism is often binary and may hamper that broader focus. And we've seen similar things happening with policies on drug trafficking or cybersecurity, two very important areas of international security, but too often confused with terrorism, you know, through what we call narco-terrorism or cyber-terrorism. Overreaction often means as well that terrorism is used as a political tool. So first of all, by authoritarian regimes in order to delegitimize political opponents and protesters, like in Libya, Syria, Egypt, Russia, and so on and so forth recently, by Western governments to gain support for military intervention, like France and Mali, or for a new law, like we've seen with C-51, for example, and new intelligence measures, or a political tool by researchers, like myself, consultants, analysts, and others to try and raise funds for their own research. So the war on terror really created that environment for this sort of things to happen and this sort of threat inflation to continue. And finally, in terms of the dangers of overreaction, overreaction also violates privacy. So the leaks by Edward Snowden have demonstrated the extent of intelligence programs and activities by the NSA, GCHQ, and other intelligence agencies around the world, very often in the name of the war against terrorism, which again is perhaps not as significant a threat as we often think. And I'll just like to conclude with some policy recommendations. Of course, each country really faces a different terrorism situation, different threat level. I wouldn't recommend the same kind of approach in Iraq as in Norway. But these are sort of 10 sort of guidelines to keep in mind when designing the sort of policy response to tackle terrorism. So the first one is the importance of being mindful of the term terrorism itself. As I said, a divisive, all-encompassive, vague, and often simplistic label. Number two, you need to understand that terrorism is a multifaceted problem that is often oversimplified and overblown. Recognizing that overestimating the threat posed by terrorism and overreacting to it has a range of negative consequences that often outweigh their benefits, including creating opportune costs, a disproportionate sense of fear, further alienation, discrimination, and violating human rights, thereby at times actually making things worse. Number four, allowing for more scrutiny, criticism, and oversight from other institutions and branches of government, like parliament, the judiciary, and civil society, including with regard to intelligence activities and the use of drones. Number five, addressing the emotional and psychological components of both terrorism and counterterrorism. Six, appreciate that governments and media narratives may play into the hands of terrorists by magnifying their importance or reinforcing and conveying their messages. Number seven, tackle the political, institutional, and socioeconomic factors behind terrorism and violent extremism instead of only confronting their symptoms. Number eight, appreciate the limits of the state in responding to terrorism and engage with media and civil society actors in preventing and countering terrorism. Number nine, adopt more balanced foreign policy postures that do not center or heavily rely on terrorism as their primary lens of analysis and response. And finally, the importance of really reviewing or having review metrics assessing policy effectiveness to include a more comprehensive analysis, including of the direct and indirect impacts of policy and not just their effectiveness. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much again for being here, and I look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Field questions then? I'll see. I'm sure our audience will have some. While people are thinking that you're going, I was struck, you mentioned both political change as one of the defining characteristics of terrorism. And I wonder how you fit in the groups that sort of try to bomb banks or federal office buildings like in Oklahoma research labs, animal rights groups, etc. Is that just the broad definition you apply in terms of political change? It strikes me that many of these folks don't really have they're not looking to alter the political system necessarily. Mm-hmm. But.
Yeah, I think the most important thing is that one of the key dimensions of those terrorist attacks and those types of terrorism really have political objectives. Whether it is change, as in specific change of governments or this kind of thing, or just a really big statement against society or really like the political fabric of society. So not, as I say, not necessarily just political change, but things like really criticizing and making a stand against governance, against society, against international organizations. So when it comes to example, like there's some hacks against banks that are really more focused just on that specific bank, or sort of revenge from former employees or this kind of stuff. So that wouldn't be considered terrorism. But if there was a big attack against the bank with some sort of manifesto of a broader political goal or societal goal, I think that should be considered terrorism. But again, a lot of people disagree on all these things, so that's my own personal view. And I'm currently working on a project called Countering Lone Actor Terrorism with Chatham House, RUSI, and other think tanks in the Netherlands and the UK. And those definitional issues came up. We had a whole workshop dedicated to it, and we still didn't solve it. We came up with our own definition of what lone actor terrorism is. But you're right, this sort of political issue came up a lot. And so people were saying, well, actually, if think the definition and our perception of what politics is and policy is pretty different, and is very different from, you know, the 70s or the 80s, where we had more more defined sort of political structures and organizations. Why here and now, you know, we have all sorts of ways to really express our sort of political goals and, you know, and ideas. So that's something as well to keep in mind. You know, the sort of definitions are always evolving as societies evolve.
I noticed in your definition of terrorism that you you said they were not, I don't know your words exactly, but non-state actors.
Yeah.
Do you ever see a situation, or could there ever be a situation that would fit within your definition of a state-sponsored terror attack or terror policy?
Yeah, I think if you qualify terrorism as state-sponsored, that is fine. You know, if it is sponsored or funded by states, you know, it does happen, but I think when attacks are carried out directly by states, I don't think it should fit within terrorism, because terrorism already encompasses such a wide range of realities that if we do include states as well, it's basically anything related to insecurity and conflict, in my opinion. So that's what problematic. And we already have some international legal frameworks to deal with this kind of state actions. So that's why I wouldn't put state actions within the remit of terrorism.
Thank you.
How do you see the new Trudeau government altering on the on Bill C-51 and other ways? What would you think would be a constructive way to alter some of what's been put in place that you might think of as extremist?
Yeah, well, I'm quite hopeful, to be honest. You know, to be fair, during the electoral campaign, I think a lot of people were a bit upset or disagreed with the liberal approach with C-51, basically saying, we disagree with it, but we'll vote for it anyway, and vote for us, and then we'll amend it, which was perhaps not the most, you know, I oversimplified what the response was, but it was perceived like that by a lot of electors. But I think now, like, one very important thing that the liberals have already changed is sort of discourse, the rhetoric, a much more positive politics, which I think will differ throughout the next few years with what we had under a conservative government. And some of the, you know, very negative discourse that we had against Muslims in particular, or, you know, the mere way that C-51 was put in place, I think was inadequate and inappropriate, in the sense that the Harper government didn't want to have any debate in Parliament or any input from experts really on how to frame it in the best way possible, and really weighing the pros and cons and analyzing sort of unintended consequences and things like that. I think the Trudeau government will be a lot more careful and collegial in their approach to how we're gonna sort of revamp C-51 and the counterterrorism policy. But again, lots of details to be sorted out in terms of review and oversight in particular of intelligence agencies. And there's probably some good things within C-51 that we should really keep. And a lot of things need to be updated, but we also, in my opinion, will need to revise the definition, for example, to make it a lot more narrow, because right now it's something like, I forget exact wording, but anything endangering the security and sovereignty of our nation, you know, with, for example, attacks on critical infrastructure, and, you know, for example, violent political protests would be, you know, legally included within the definition. So I think there's definitely a lot of work for liberals to do, but I am hopeful.
Do you think it's going to be a priority for them?
I mean, I think there's a lot of priorities at the moment, but I think C-51 was such a divisive and controversial bill that they will be very keen within the appropriate ministries to do something with it as soon as possible.